This is a case of a 25-year-old female who hails from RT Nagar, Bangalore, and she's a homemaker by occupation. Her husband, Mr. XYZ, 30 years old and mechanic by occupation, and he is educated till 10th standard. And they belong to lower middle socioeconomic status according to modified Kuppaswamy. Date of examination was on 13th February 2020. Then last menstrual period was on 20th May 2019. And estimated date of delivery is on 27th February 2020. And then she is a primi gravida and period of gestation is 38 weeks and 3 days.
Yeah, just a minute. Still, you cannot come out of your ABC, Mrs. ABC and wife of Mr. XYZ. I told you, like, as far as possible, try to avoid these things, you know. 25-year-old primi gravida coming from, okay, like whatever this thing, no, place, RT Nagar. She is a homemaker. Husband is a mechanic, educated, like that you can tell, understood? Yeah, you don't have to tell Mrs. ABC or Mrs. X and wife of Mr. Y. All such things you should avoid, okay?
Yeah, ma'am.
In the exams, anyway, you will be telling. It is because this is in a bigger forum where you don't want to reveal patient's identity. You are using all these, you know, alphabets and whatnot. But otherwise, in the exam, you will be telling her name, isn't it? Even in a clinical case discussion, suppose I am discussing a case, you will be telling the name of the patient, right? Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So, as far as possible, try to avoid that Mrs. ABC and Mr. XYZ. Of course, you should not reveal patient's name in this forum. You can just start with this. I told you, I think from the first class itself, I told you, 25-year-old primi gravida coming from RT Nagar, Bangalore. Okay. She's a homemaker. Her education 10th standard. Her husband is a mechanic, educated till 10th standard. They belong to. So you split the sentences and then you can just present. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, for me, at least you present that. I don't know about other teachers.
Yeah, yes. Ma.
Yeah. Yeah, you go ahead, ma.
Yeah, ma. A primary gravida with 9 months of amenorrhea has come for safe confinement. No history of pain abdomen, bleed or leak per vagina, headache, blurring of vision, and swelling of legs. Fetal movements are well perceived.
Okay.
Next, obstetric history. Married life for 2 years. Married for 2 years, non-consanguineous marriage. They use barrier method of contraception for 1 year. Then last menstrual period, 20th May 2019, EDD, 27th February 2020, gestational age 38 weeks, 3 days. She is a primi gravida and booked case at Vani Vilas Hospital, Bangalore.
Now, one more thing, you know, see, you mentioned LMP, EDD in the beginning itself. That's a good habit, okay? So the examiner will come to know that, okay, she's a primi gravida of 25-year-old and she's 38 weeks and her LMP is this and this. That is okay. But in obstetric history, you don't have to tell LMPDD. This LMPDD will come in menstrual history, not in obstetric history. Understood?
Yeah,
in obstetric history, you will be telling about married life, whether it is consanguineous, non-consanguineous, any, of course, history of contraception and about her antenatal period, if she is a primi gravida. Yes.
Okay, ma'am. History of present pregnancy, first trimester. It's a history of spontaneous conception. Pregnancy was confirmed by urine pregnancy test at 1 month of missed period at the hospital. Then first trimester scan was done. It was found to be normal and corresponding with the dates. Then TD first dose was taken at first visit. Folic acid tablets were taken. No history of excessive vomiting, fever with rashes. No history of bleeding or discharge per vagina. No history of pain abdomen. No history of blurring, burning micturition, increased frequency of micturition. No history of exposure to radiation and drug intake. Patient underwent routine and investigation and was told that the reports were normal.
Okay. Yeah. So this is the routine history that you're going to ask in any case, isn't it?
Yeah, ma'am.
Yes.
Quickening was felt at 5th month. Second trimester scan was done at 5th month and it was found to be normal. Second dose stereo was taken. Iron and folic acid tablets were taken. Calcium tablets were also taken. And no history of fever, increased frequency of burning micturition. No history of pedal edema, blurring of vision or headache. No history of polyuria or polydipsia. No history of pain abdomen. No history of leaking or bleeding per vagina.
What was the interval between the first dose of TDVAC and the second dose of TD?
At least 4 to 6 weeks interval, ma'am.
Okay. So it was fitting into that?
Yeah, mostly, ma'am. This was the history given, ma'am.
Okay, fine.
Next, third trimester. Continued perception of fetal movements. Iron and calcium tablets were taken. Obstetric scan was done and was found to be normal. No history of fever, increased frequency of micturition or burning of micturition. Then no history of pedal edema, blurring of vision and headache. No history of polyuria or polydipsia. No history of pain abdomen, leaking or bleeding per vagina. Weight gain was 10 kg.
Now, just go back one slide back. Second trimester, okay. Anything else you would like to do in second trimester? You would like to include?
I'm at 24 to 28 weeks. Glucose test, OGTT can also be done.
Yeah, single step. Yes, single step glucose tolerance test should be done, isn't it?
Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah, DIPSY.
Yeah.
So that should be mentioned here, okay? Because it's a special test that you do, whether you have done or not. Is it important in case in relation to your case presentation today? So you are presenting breach.
It can result in macrosomia, ma'am. So macrosomia can also result in breach presentation.
Okay. Now, suppose there is a breach presentation and mother is having some problem, okay? Some other medical problem, associated problem, I would say. What do you call that condition?
Got that? Complicated breach.
Yes. So it is complicated breach. So your management, many a times, the management will differ. Understood? Whether it is a complicated breach or uncomplicated breach. So it's totally different from complications of breach, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, what do you mean by complications of breach?
Different. Ma'am, yeah. Complications of breach? Ma'am, in the sense...
Yeah, complications of breach means the complications which are inherent to breach presentation. You got that point?
It leads to increased incidence of cesarean section and...
I just wanted to ask you, what do you mean by complications of breach? What do you mean by complicated breach? So you should know the difference, okay?
So complicated breach is a condition in which certain maternal and obstetric complications are present along with the breach presentation, like placenta previa, multiple pregnancy, prematurity. Complications due to breach.
Complications which are inherent to breach presentation are complications of breach. Understood? So that's right, because uncomplicated breach, you can think of so many things. You can do some manipulations. You can allow her for breach delivery, maybe assisted breach delivery. And if it becomes complicated breach, you will think twice, understood, to allow her for a normal vaginal delivery. So that is the difference, to identify all the risk factors in the mother. That's why you're asking all this negative history, right? No history of pedal edema, no history of polyuria, this, that, all those things. Understood?
Yeah, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Yeah. So you want to make sure that there are no maternal complications and it is not a complicated breech. Okay, yeah, fine. Ma'am. Yeah. So third trimester, yes, you are going, you were telling something about, we were in third trimester.
Yeah, ma'am.
So you have written here, OGTT normal. That is third trimester you have written.
Ma'am, here was a written history of, no history of polyuria and polydipsia.
And I see these, you think gestational diabetes patient will have polyuria, polydipsia?
No, ma'am.
They may not have anything understood, but still they can have macrosomia, right?
Yeah.
One of the complications of gestational diabetes is macrosomia.
Yeah.
So that's why this history, of course, it is suggestive of typical diabetes, type 2 diabetes, maybe, or type 1 diabetes also, who knows. Like she wouldn't have known for the first time she's coming to you, maybe on investigation it will be found out. So all these things will not rule out gestational diabetes. Your only screening test will rule out gestational diabetes. Understood?
Okay, ma'am.
Yes. So I'm wondering, like, how come in the third trimester you have written OGTT and not in the second trimester? Okay, fine. So how often you'll be doing this OGTT, single step OGTT? How often you'll be doing?
Ma'am, first, at the first antenatal visit itself, it's done.
Yes, yes.
That is, and then if the female is diabetic, then
she is on treatment. If it is normal, then when you will repeat it?
Ma'am, again, it has to be repeated at between 24 to 28 weeks, ma'am.
Yeah, ideally speaking, at 24th week. Okay, then? Third trimester, are you going to repeat it again?
Third trimester.
What is the Government of India guideline says? You think Indian women are at increased risk of developing gestational diabetes?
Could be, ma'am. Yeah, ma'am.
Not could be, yes.
Yeah, ma'am.
It's a big yes. Understood.
Yes,
so, India is the capital city for diabetes. Understood?
Yes, ma'am.
So, you have, that's why Indian women are considered as at-risk population. And we are doing, either actually Government of India has recommends 3 times OGTT. One is at the time of registration, second is 24th week when there is, maximum, glucose intolerance can happen, like carbohydrate metabolism disturbances can happen. And the third time is 32 weeks. See, sometimes a small percentage of women can be detected at third trimester at 32 weeks. Now, I personally had 2-3 patients like that who were, at 24th week normal, but OGTT was abnormal in the third trimester. So that's why Government of India doesn't want to take any risk. So all the 3 distinct tests should be done, ideally speaking. Early registration, 24th week and 32 weeks. There was a question like, what is the difference between GCT and GTT?
Ma'am, glucose challenge test?
Yeah.
Ma'am, it is?
Yes. So here, see, GCT, I'll just briefly tell you, okay? GCT is like, it is a double, what I'm telling is single step OGTT, it is, okay? So you are giving 75 gram of oral glucose irrespective of the meal and taking blood sugar 2 hours after the meal, okay? I mean, of course, after the, this thing. I mean, you are taking blood sugar 2 hours after the meal, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Means you are giving 75 grams of glucose and you are taking blood sugar after 2 hours of that. But here OGCT, you are giving 50 grams of oral glucose, and if that is found to be abnormal, then you have to repeat the OGTT. So that will be double test. Understood?
Yes,
so twice you have to do the test. So in Indian, like Indian women, no, when see, usually they attend government hospitals, they'll be coming from far off places, maybe from village. They may not be coming on empty stomach also. Understood. So that's why this Dipsy has given this guideline that irrespective of her last meal, you have to give her 75 gram of oral glucose and conduct the, take the blood, test for blood glucose 2 hours after that. Okay. Yes, so that is the difference between OGTT and GCT, and then again doing this thing, so it's a double test. Okay. Hmm. Right.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah. So in third trimester, you have written OGTT normal. That means to say that it was done in the third trimester?
Yeah, ma'am.
In this case?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. So she has missed the bus maybe in the second trimester. So they have done it in the third trimester, maybe. I don't know. Yeah.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, fine.
Then menstrual history, age of attainment of menarche at 13 years. Mm-hmm. Then past cycles, regular cycles of 30 days, flow for 3 to 4 days, then change of 2 to 3 pads per day, no history of passage of clots or dysmenorrhea, then LMP 20th May 2019.
Yeah, here you can add your EDD also, okay? So in the obstetric history, you don't have to mention, here you can add LMP is this and EDD is this. Okay, fine. Next.
Next, past history, not a known case of diabetes, hypertension, tuberculosis, epilepsy, asthma, and thyroid disorders, no history of blood transfusion, no history of previous surgeries, no history of drug allergies.
Fine.
Next, family history, no history of bleeding disorder, no history of congenital anomalies, no history of twinning in the family, no history of diabetes, hypertension, asthma, TB, or epilepsy.
Right.
Next, personal history. Diet is mixed. Appetite is normal. Sleep is adequate. Bowel and bladder regular. No history of substance abuse.
Okay.
Right. Then summary. A 25-year-old primary gravida with history of 9 months of amenorrhea has come for safe confinement. Fetal movements are well perceived.
Okay, you didn't do yeah, okay, fine.
Next, general physical examination. Here's a young lady who is moderately built and nourished. She is conscious, cooperative, and well-oriented to time.
One more thing, Manasa. See, you don't have to tell the summary in between, understood? See, summary is like overall, like when you finish your examination, you do the, you give the summary and then final diagnosis. That's all. Understood? Yeah. Yeah. So I was a little confused when you gave the summary. Maybe you had not done the physical examination. So it's not like that. Okay, fine.
Yeah, ma'am. Height is 160 centimeters. Pre-pregnancy weight 61 kg, current weight 73 kg, BMI 23.8 kg per meter square, vitals pulse rate 78 beats per minute regular, blood pressure 118 bars 76 mm of Hg, respiratory rate 16 cycles per minute, and patient is afebrile.
This BMI, how did you calculate?
Ma'am, weight by height square.
Which weight did you take?
Ma'am, pre-pregnancy weight.
Yeah, okay, fine. So you have to take the pre-pregnancy weight. If she knows about her pre-pregnancy weight, then only you can calculate BMI. Otherwise, maybe if she's in the first trimester, you can, because in the first trimester, we don't expect weight gain, isn't it? So maybe in the first trimester, early first trimester weight or pre-pregnancy weight should be taken into consideration when you are calculating the BMI. So what is your comment on BMI? Is it normal?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, it is normal. Yes. Is it important for us?
Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah. So if she is obese, there will be a lot of problems if she has breech presentation, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Okay, fine.
No pallor, icterus, cyanosis, lymphadenopathy, edema, and clubbing. Breast, spine, and thyroid are normal.
Okay.
Next is per abdominal examination, inspection. Shape of the abdomen is distended. It appears longitudinally oval. Flanks are full. Umbilicus is central and everted. Linea nigrans stria gravidarum are visualized. No scars, sinuses or dilated veins can be seen. And then hernial orifices are intact.
Okay.
Next, palpation. Inspectory findings are confirmed. Abdominal girth of 99 centimeters at the level of umbilicus. Then fundal height, 32 weeks with flank fullness corresponding to the gestational age. Then obstetric grips, fundal grip, hard ballottable mass suggestive of fetal head. Right lateral grip, uniform, continuously curved resistance suggestive of spine. Left lateral grip, multiple knob-like structures suggestive of limbs. First pelvic grip, broad, soft, irregular mass suggestive of breech. Second pelvic grip, fingers are diverging.
Right. Okay. So just one slide back. So right lateral grip, uniform, continuous curved assistance. So back is on the right side, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Next.
Fetal heart sound heard just around the umbilicus. Rate is 140 beats per minute. I would like to do per vaginal examination and bimanual examination.
Okay, I understand why you want to do per vaginal examination. Why you want to do per vaginal examination?
Ma'am, per vaginal examination can be done to know the presenting part, ma'am. And
are you not happy with your per abdominal findings?
Ma'am, to confirm or to know the membrane status.
What
dilation?
Okay, she is not in labor. She had just come for safe confinement, isn't it?
Yeah, ma'am.
Whenever you do a per vaginal examination, you have to justify your examination. Okay. So in this case, I would say because she is a primi gravida, maybe you wanted to assess the pelvis. Understood?
Yeah, ma'am.
So then you are justified. Okay. So pelvis can be assessed at term, okay? Any time after 37 weeks. Now she has come to you at 38 weeks. You would like to plan. Maybe you want to discuss with her what would be her mode of delivery by chance, you know? So if you can do a pelvic examination and find out that, okay, this is a straight forward case of contracted pelvis, straight away you can tell her. See, now you have got contracted pelvis and this breech presentation. You are not going to deliver vaginally. See, so you have to justify why you are doing per vaginal examination. Understood? In any particular case. So in this particular case, if at all you have done a per vaginal examination, that may be to assess the pelvis because she is term. She is term and she is a primi gravida. She is having breech presentation. Understood?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, bimanual examination. Why you want to do bimanual examination?
Ma'am, again, pelvimetry only, ma'am.
Pelvimetry, where you are doing bimanual examination, dear? See, this bimanual examination comes in gynec. Understood? Okay. Bimanual pelvic examination comes in gynec. Don't mistake that for obstetric examination. In obstetrics, it will be per vaginal examination only. Per speculum, sometimes you may do, say, if the patient has come with bleeding or some discharge or some watery discharge, you want to confirm whether she has got leaking PV. So in such a situation, maybe you would have done a per speculum examination. Next step, next you will do per vaginal examination where you will use only two fingers, right hand, understood, unless you are a left-hander. So you are not using both the hands here when you are doing a per vaginal examination. In gynec, you are using both the hands. Understood? That's why it is called as bimanual pelvic examination. When you are doing a pelvic examination, okay, assessment also, you'll be using only two fingers. Understood? Index and the middle finger. So it will be a paravaginal examination in case of obstetrics. If you say bimanual examination, you are wrong. Understood?
Okay.
Yeah. So these things you should know. Okay, fine. Now, suppose you said you wanted to confirm that it is breech presentation. In this case, do you think that you have any doubt regarding the presentation? I don't think. See, head is palatable. You have felt it at the fundus and you felt some broader irregular mass at the lower pole. And it is mobile, isn't it? That is most important. So instead of telling like it is, you know, the fingers are diverging and all that, whether that breech, whatever this thing presenting part, that presentation that you are feeling at the lower pole, whether it is engaged or not, or mobile. Is it mobile? Okay.
Yeah.
Was it mobile?
No, ma'am. Lower pole.
It was not mobile.
Yeah.
You could feel, did you feel or you got the findings through somebody else?
Ma'am, I got the findings, ma'am.
Ah, that's why. See, usually, you know, suppose you are feeling a firm and broader mass at the lower pole, most probably you are able to feel it properly, isn't it? That shows that it is a mobile presentation, right?
Yes, ma'am.
But if you are not, like lower pole is empty, you think lower pole is empty, you cannot feel. See, lower pole empty means it can be only two things. Either the head is deeply engaged or it could be a malpresentation.
Malpresentation.
Understood?
Yes,
so, if you are not feeling anything there, maybe it is an extended breech which it could have been engaged. You are right in telling that, okay? Now, suppose this is same patient comes to you in labor. She comes in labor, okay? So, when she comes in labor and if she had not come to you earlier, say, so that you could diagnose that it was breech presentation, during contraction, sometimes it may be difficult for you to say, yeah, the part which I felt at the fundus was hard and palatable and things like that, okay? In such a situation, you are justified in doing a paravaginal examination and differentiating the thing, I mean, or confirming that it is breech presentation, right? Provided the cervix is slightly dilated and you can feel something over there when you do a paravaginal examination, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, now that you have raised this point, paravaginal examination, you wanted to confirm breech presentation. Suppose the patient is in labor, okay? She has come to you in labor and you are doing a paravaginal examination. You are feeling some soft parts, okay? You're feeling something soft there, okay? It's not hard, you know. See, when nowadays, of course, because of the ultrasound scan, every woman would have undergone ultrasound scan, and you would know that, okay, this is breech presentation. But in your presentation, I just noted that in third trimester scan was done and it was found to be normal. That shows that there was no breech presentation at that time, right?
Oh, yeah, ma'am.
See, usually if there is breech presentation in the third trimester scan, usually nowadays they go for even growth scan, 34, 36 weeks like that. So in that, during that period, if it was a breech presentation, maybe you would have known by then itself. Isn't it?
Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah. So suppose she is in labor and you are doing a paravaginal examination and you are feeling soft part. How to differentiate or how to confirm that it is breech and not anything else, or face presentation? Sometimes you can mistake.
It is mainly the relationship between the ischial spine and the genital orifice. It will be in straight line in case of breech, but in case of face presentation, malar bone and the mouth form a triangle. Next, suckling reflex is present in face presentation, and alveolar prominence can also be felt. Meconium staining when finger is passed through the anal canal in case of breach, ma'am.
Yeah. So saying that it is anal orifice, not the genital orifice, okay? Anal orifice and the ischial tuberosities are in the same straight line. Okay, fine. So other things now, as you said, that's how you differentiate it from face presentation. And how to differentiate it from head, you know. So during labor, sometimes it may be difficult for you. Soft, usually head will be felt hard only, okay. But sometimes if there is a big caput and all, it may be difficult. So if she has come in advanced labor, okay. In such situations, maybe you have to go for a ultrasound scan, okay. So now that you have confirmed that it is breech presentation, okay, you are diagnosed that it is breech presentation, you finish off your case, then we will go for discussion. You have come up to auscultation, yes.
Ma'am, CVS S1, S2 normally heard, respiratory system, normal vesicular breath sounds heard, CNS examination, higher mental functions are intact. Then summary, a 20-year-old primi gravida with history of 9 months of amenorrhea comes for safe confinement. She is not in labor and fetal movements are well perceived. On obstetric examination, fundal height corresponds to 32 weeks with a flank fullness and single live fetus is palpated. Then with soft continuous mass on first pelvic grip suggestive of breech, fetal heart sounds are normal.
Now, on obstetric examination, fundal height corresponds to 32 weeks with flank fullness. You can just say on obstetric examination, she is a term pregnancy with a single live fetus, palpated with soft continuous mass on first pelvic grip, suggestive of breech. Okay, soft continuous mass. What is this?
Ma'am, like soft mass, ma'am.
No, don't say continuous mass.
Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah, there is nothing like continuous mass or interrupted mass. Understood. So it's a soft, broad, irregular mass.
Okay, broad, irregular.
Suggest your breech. Okay, right then. Fetal heart sounds are normal. Okay, fine. Okay. Right. Then, what is your diagnosis?
Ma'am, a 24-year-old primi gravida with 38 weeks of gestation with a single live fetus, intrauterine pregnancy, longitudinal live, breech presentation with normal heart rate.
Single live fetus, don't say intrauterine pregnancy now, understood?
Okay.
So, single live fetus in longitudinal lie with breech presentation and normal fetal heart rate. Okay, fine. So, she is term primi gravida. Okay. So, how will you confirm that it is breech presentation? Are you worried? Are you worried in this case?
Yeah, ma'am.
You are worried. Why you are worried?
Since it's term, external cephalic version should be done at the earliest, if not.
So you are worried that you have to do one external cephalic version. Is that the thing? So what are you worried about? See, you are worried about the fetus, isn't it?
Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah, see, there will be a lot of problems for the baby, right? So you are worried about the complications now, you know, whether I should allow her for vaginal delivery, what would be the mode of delivery. So those things you are worried about, right?
Yeah.
So first of all, you have to confirm that it is breech presentation. Your clinical diagnosis always should be confirmed. Understood?
Yeah.
So how will you confirm breech presentation?
Ma'am, UST, ultrasound can be done.
Okay, now when you do ultrasound examination, what are all the things, other information that you would like to gather apart from the fact that you are confirming the diagnosis?
Ma'am, USG, it is used to know the type of bridge, then okay. attitude of the head, then attachment of the placenta, and it also gives other parameters like biparietal diameter, gestational age, and fetal weight can also be known, and then any uterine malformations can be known, yeah. and also volume of Likert.
Yes, that is the most important. That is also important, isn't it? So you have to know what is the type of breach. So what are the types of breach?
Ma'am, types of breach, there are two types, complete breach and incomplete breach. In complete breach, the attitude of the fetus is flexed. There is flexion of thighs, flexion of knees, and the presenting yeah. part consists of two buttocks, then external genitalia, and two lower limb, fetal parts.
So don't say that, you know, the fetus is in flexed attitude, only the polarity is changed. Understood? Instead of cephalic presentation, there is a podalic presentation, that's all.
Yeah, ma'am.
Incomplete breach. So if it is incomplete, what types you have?
Ma'am, there are three types. Extended breach, and footling presentation, and knee presentation.
Okay, which is the most common one?
The most common is frank breach, ma'am, with extended legs.
Yeah. So, frank breach is the most common, almost like, say, 60 to 70%, almost some say even 80%. So, complete breach about, again, 10 to 20%, and footling and knee presentation, it's another 10 to 20%, okay? So, these are the types of breach. So, you should know, like, what is the type of breach? Why you should know?
Ma'am, because footling presentation and knee presentation, it's always cesarean section. Only the flexed breech and extended vaginal assisted breech delivery can be tried.
Yes. And one more thing is, like, you know, if it is you are planning for, you said you are thinking of doing external cephalic version. So a frank breech may be, it may be difficult because of that splinting of the legs. It may be difficult for you to do the external cephalic version. It is not an ideal case. Understood? A complete breach, yes, external cephalic version is quite easy. Understood? So that's why you should do an ultrasound scan to know all these things. And you also should know the position of the back if possible, okay, where the back is, so that while doing external cephalic version, it may help you, okay? You said about the weight of the baby and Likert and position of the placenta. And most important thing is anomaly of the uterus. At this gestational age, it may not be possible. That's why, like, when you do a first trimester scan or even the, say, second trimester scan, both anomaly of the fetus and uterus both should be ruled out at that particular time. Understood?
Yeah.
Yeah. Because what are the causes? Why do you think this breach is quite common, or is it not so common?
Not so common, ma'am. Generally, spontaneous version occurs, but if anything is not letting it happen, it presents as breach.
Yes, yes. So it depends. See, the frequency of breach presentation depends upon the gestational age, isn't it? See, at 28 weeks, suppose I ask you the incidence of breech presentation, it may be as high as 20%. And if it is at, say, 32, 34 weeks, it may be as low as 5%. And at term, it may be just 3%. That's all. Understood? So prematurity, suppose if at 28 weeks, she happens to go into labor, then naturally the breech that was there, it will persist and she will have breech presentation. Understood? So that's why the most common cause. What are the etiological factors for breech presentation?
Ma'am, most importantly, prematurity.
Yes, and, that's right, prematurity, yes.
Yeah, ma'am. Mm-hmm. And next, the causes that are not letting the fetus to undergo spontaneous version, like multiple pregnancy, short cord, oligohydramnios, and then congenital malformations of the uterus.
Yeah, these are maternal factors and fetal factors.
ma'am, congenital anomalies, trisomy 21, 13.
See, somebody is already like, no, placental causes, uterine causes, or fetal causes. Maternal, fetal, you can just divide like that. What is that? Somebody is, somebody has to mute themselves. Okay, fine. So the fetal causes would be mainly
hydrocephalus, mom.
Yeah, mostly hydrocephalus, but even anencephaly also sometimes can have breech presentation. Yeah.
Yeah.
Then, even intrauterine fetal death, they say, you know, sometimes there can be breech presentation. And of course, as you said, prematurity. Yeah, yeah. These are some of the causes. And placental attachment. Placental causes would be?
Placenta previa, ma'am.
Only placenta previa. Anything else? Have you heard of fundal corneal attachment of the
placenta? Fundal attachment, yeah, ma'am.
See, there is something called as recurrent breech presentation. What do you mean by recurrent breech presentation?
If three consecutive pregnancies are breech, then
yeah,
that is
you call it as recurrent breech. So yeah. Can you tell me the causes for recurrent breech presentation?
Ma'am, conopundyl attachment of placenta.
Yes. So three C's you should remember. Three C's. Understood?
Okay, ma'am.
One is corneal fundal attachment, yes.
Then congenital malformation of uterus.
Yeah. Congenital malformation of the uterus and?
Contracted pelvis.
Yes. Contracted pelvis. So that's why, like, you know, these three C's you should remember. So any malpresentation, first thing you should rule out is contracted pelvis and any congenital malformation of the uterus and congenital malformation of the fetus. Understood? So these three things you should always rule out. And for recurrent breech, corneal fundal attachment of the placenta, sometimes it recurs. Okay. So that's why recurrent breech presentation, you have to rule out these three C's. Okay, fine. Right. Yeah. Now, you were talking about, you are worried about this breech presentation. What are the problems that you anticipate? Why you are worried? What are the problems for the baby? What are the problems for the mother?
Breech presentation. Okay. Maternal problems like damage to the genital tract, ma'am.
Yeah.
Perineal tear during the delivery.
Mm. Yes.
And sepsis can happen. Fetal causes like intrauterine growth restriction or fetal death. And then due to compression and decompression of the head, there could be a tear of the tentorium cerebellum.
No, don't talk about IUGR and things like that. Because of the breech presentation, what are the problems a baby, fetus can face? Understood? So one thing is, of course, you said there is increased maternal morbidity. Understood? Because of, operative intervention, like some obstetric intervention you have to do during delivery, suppose it is assisted breech delivery, or she may have to undergo cesarean operation, that itself will increase the morbidity, isn't it? So there is increased maternal morbidity. And for the baby also, there is increased perinatal morbidity as well as mortality.
Mortality.
Yeah. So what is the mortality?
Mortality 9 to 25%, ma'am.
Yeah, it is quite
without
high. Yes, as compared to vertex presentation, breech presentation, perinatal mortality is as high as 9 to 25%. Understood? So what are all the and why do you think perinatal mortality is more? What problems baby can have? You said decompression and sudden decompression of the fetal head, and it may lead to what?
Intracranial hemorrhage or fracture of the fetal skull.
Mainly, there will be tear of the tentorium cerebelli, and there may be hemorrhage. Understood? That is the most common thing. So compression and decompression, sudden compression and decompression. That's why we should be very, very careful while delivering the after coming head. Understood?
Okay.
And fracture of the skull, you said. Then even the condyles, there may be fracture of the condyles. Okay. Then where are all? You just tell me about fracture, where all it can, she can, the baby can have fracture. One is skull fracture, condylar fracture. Then?
Mama, fracture of the femur, humerus, fifth and sixth cervical vertebra, and odontoid process fracture. And then? Mom?
Clavicular fracture. Okay.
Clavicular fracture.
Oh, yeah.
And... injury to the visceral organs like lung, kidney, liver, and hematoma of the testes. Mm-hmm. And then birth asphyxia secondary to the cord prolapse and cord compression, prolonged labor, mm-hmm. and a premature attempt at respiration. And there could be spinal injuries, mainly of cervical and brachial plexus, resulting in Ebb's palsy and Klumke's palsy.
Yes, okay. There can be injury to the adrenal glands also. Understood? Very important. So all these things can happen. That's why there is increased perinatal morbidity as well as mortality. And birth asphyxia is more because, as you said, it could be because of the cord prolapse or cord compression, right? And because of the premature attempt at respiration, even when the head is inside. So there'll be aspiration of the amniotic fluid, so, and compression of the fetal head. So because of all these things, there can be birth asphyxia. Okay, fine. Now tell me, like, suppose now you are seeing this patient, what are the options for her? Like, you have to counsel her now, no?
Yeah, ma'am. Ma'am, vaginal delivery or cesarean section.
Mm-hmm.
In case of vaginal delivery, external cephalic version could be done. And if that is successful, vaginal delivery can be done. Or is a cesarean section, ma'am? If there are any contraindications to vaginal delivery, then a cesarean section can be done.
So you're not thinking about assisted vaginal breech delivery?
Ma'am, that can assisted vaginal breech delivery.
Yeah. See, options are like for this patient now, she has come to you. You have options of external cephalic version because she's only 38 weeks, not in labor. Ideal candidate, she's a primary gravida, provided there are no contraindications for vaginal delivery. Okay. You are going ahead with the external cephalic version. And otherwise, you will allow her, you counsel her if the patient, if pelvis is good and baby is average weight. So what are the factors which are favorable for assisted vaginal delivery or breech delivery?
Breech delivery, if weight of the fetus is between 1.5 to 3.5 kgs, and then... if the head is if the presentation is not footling or knee presentation, zatiopnea score is more than or equal to 4, vaginal delivery can be done. And
what is this zatiopnea Andrews score, breech scoring system? You said if it is more, then I will allow her for vaginal delivery. What is this Zatiopnea Andrews scoring, breech score?
Ma'am, it is based on parameters like parity, gestational age.
How many parameters are taken into consideration?
Ma'am, 6.
Six parameters are there. Okay, fine. Yeah. So what are those factors?
Ma'am, parity.
Parity, gestation. Yeah. So parity, okay, she's primary para. What score you will give? 0, isn't it?
Yeah, ma'am.
0, 1, 2 is the scoring. And if she is primary para, then definitely it is 0. And if she's multi-para, so you give 1 or 2, okay? Yeah. Then
gestational age.
Yeah, gestational age, yes.
And then a previous cesarean section.
So gestational age is 39, 38, and 37 weeks. Understood, less than 37 weeks. So, but preterm baby, when it is less than, say, 1.5 kg baby, as you mentioned, it is a in case for cesarean. It is an indication for cesarean delivery. Understood? Okay, fine.
Next, fetal weight.
Yeah.
Fetal weight is important.
Yes.
And,
yeah. So, if the fetal weight, of course, it is he gives in pounds, 8 pounds, it's almost like 3.5 kg, 3.6 kg almost. 7 to 8 kg would be ideal, okay? Or less than 7 kg would be ideal, okay? No, but not less than 1.5 kg, yes. Okay?
Yeah, ma'am.
Then? So, parity, gestational age, you said about the fetal weight, and then? Cervical dilatation, understood? So if she's already in labor, no, say 4 centimeter cervical dilatation, it is a favorable factor, understood? And station of the fetal
station.
Head. Yes. So if it is minus station, then you will rather, you know, it is almost zero score if it is minus 3. Minus 2 means you may give 1 score. If it is minus 1 or 0 station, you may give 2 scores, understood? And most important is history of previous breech deliveries, understood? Suppose she gives history, she is a multiparous woman, she has already delivered a breech by breech presentation, then that will be the most favorable factor, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So previous breech, this also is another factor. So these are the 6 factors that you, parameters that you take into consideration. You give scoring 0, 1, 2, and if it is more than 4, she'll be for vaginal delivery. So that is roughly like how you decide about the mode of delivery. So you have to know, like, by ultrasound scan and clinical estimation, also you can make out like what is the weight of this baby, and you assess the pelvis, if the pelvis is good, and maybe you will allow her to go for spontaneous labor. One more thing is, induction of labor or spontaneous. See, spontaneous labor, if she goes into spontaneous labor, then that will be a favorable factor for assisted breech delivery. Understood?
Yeah.
Can she have spontaneous breech delivery?
Sorry, ma'am.
See, the mode of delivery would be either spontaneous breech delivery, assisted breech delivery, breech extraction, or cesarean delivery, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
So, can she have spontaneous breech delivery?
Yeah, ma'am.
In which condition she can have spontaneous breech delivery?
Ma'am, I didn't get you.
See, spontaneous, it is impossible. Even the frank breech patient cannot have spontaneous breech delivery. You have to, assist. You have to use some maneuvers so that she will deliver normally. Understood? Spontaneous breech delivery can happen only, say, if there is a macerated fetus with breech presentation, a very small baby, and if she's a multiparous woman, she goes into preterm labor and suddenly she may just deliver spontaneously. Understood? Unassisted. But otherwise, it is not possible for with breech presentation to have spontaneous breech delivery. It is most of the times, if at all, vaginal delivery, it will be a assisted vaginal delivery or maybe breech extraction. Now, okay. What is the difference between assisted breech delivery and breech extraction? So,
ma'am, in assisted breech delivery, assistance is given from the beginning till the end of the delivery of the fetus, but breech extraction is complete extraction is done by the obstetrician.
What is the difference then? You said from the beginning assistance is given, here completely breech is delivered.
Like spontaneous delivery occurs whenever like interventions are needed, like certain maneuvers are needed. Only that time maneuvers are done, or
In assisted breech
delivery.
No. See, assisted breech delivery means up to the delivery of the umbilicus, you are not doing anything except giving episiotomy. Understood? You're just watching. So all the maneuvers will start only after the delivery of the up to umbilicus. Understood? In a breech extraction, from the beginning, from the delivery of the breech itself, you are assisting. So this breech extraction, most of the time, like you in an emergency, say there is a cord prolapse and full cervical dilatation, you cannot shift her to the OT, there is no OT facility or something like that. You're sitting in a PSC, you may have to do a breech extraction, starting from the delivery of the breech to shoulders, everything you'll be doing yourself. Understood? That is breech extraction. Whereas assisted breech delivery up to the delivery up to the umbilicus, you are not doing anything. Understood?
Okay.
Now, tell me, how do you, what is the mechanism of labor in breech presentation?
Now, I have got a dummy and you keep telling,
you explain, what is the mechanism of labor? This is usually asked in your practical exam, okay? Usually they will ask you, what is the mechanism? Left sacroanterior, you show me the presentation and tell me the mechanism of labor in left sacroanterior position. Can you tell?
Ma'am, I'm not...
Mechanism of labor.
Okay, ma'am. First delivery of the buttocks, most common position is left sacroanterior. So the engaging diameter is...
Yes, this is the left sacroanterior. This is the left anterior quadrant. This is the sacrum over here. Okay, fine. So... Yes.
Yeah, ma'am. Left sacroanterior. The engaging diameter is bitrochanteric diameter, which is about 10 centimeters.
Yes.
And the buttocks lie in left oblique diameter.
Yeah. So this bitrochanteric diameter gets engaged in the left oblique diameter. Okay, fine. So there is descent with the compaction. Vertex presentation, you have descent with increased flexion, isn't it? Here the breech becomes more compact, okay? And there is descent, there is engagement in the left oblique diameter, descent with compaction. Next would be, what is the next movement?
Ma'am, next, when the anterior buttock touches the pelvic floor, internal rotation occurs by 1/8 of a circle, such that anterior buttock lies behind the pubic symphysis.
Yeah. So when it touches the pelvic floor, now I'm showing at the brim because it just cannot go down. Understood? Okay. So it is in the left oblique diameter. It rotates through 1/8 of a circle here. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Right. And anterior buttock hitches against the pubic symphysis. And what happens then?
And then by lateral flexion, anterior buttock is delivered first, followed by posterior buttock.
It actually, the pelvis is inclined like that, isn't it? It's tilted this way. So the posterior buttock enters into the pelvis first. Understood? So anterior buttock will be under the pubic symphysis. By lateral flexion, the posterior buttock is born first and then the anterior buttock just slips out. Understood?
Okay.
So next, what happens? So the mechanism of labor you may have to describe at three levels. One, so your buttocks, these buttocks are born now. Okay. Right. Next.
Next, restitution by 1/8 of a circle. So it goes back to the original.
So it will get born like that. And now it will be again rotated through 1/8 of a circle. It will stay like this. Understood? Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
This is some disorientation with the picture and the thing. Okay. Okay.
Ma'am, next, delivery of the legs and the trunk occurs.
It's already baby's breech. Provided it is a complete breach, it's already out. Even if it is frank breach, you would have delivered the legs by now, right?
The
shoulders, understood? So, engagement of the shoulders now. Which is the engaging diameter here?
Ma'am, this acromion diameter.
Yeah. So which diameter of the pelvis it gets engaged?
Again, left oblique diameter.
Same left oblique diameter, understood. So it will get engaged in the left oblique diameter only, okay? This this is the bis acromial diameter. How much is it?
12 centimeters.
Yeah. So 10 centimeter, 12 centimeter and 10 centimeter. Just remember, engaging diameters, okay? So left oblique diameter, the shoulder gets engaged, okay? Because it's already like restitution. So shoulder gets engaged and then?
Descent and internal rotation by 1/8 of a circle such that anterior shoulder is present behind pubic symphysis.
Yeah. So again, same this thing, direction it will rotate. So the breech had rotated through 1/8 of circle in this direction. So shoulder also will rotate through 1/8 of a circle in this direction. So anterior shoulder hitches against the pubic symphysis and bilateral flexion. Posterior shoulder is born and then the anterior shoulder comes out, okay? So now again, there will be?
Restitution by 1/8.
So restitution and 1/8 of a circle. So it will remain like this, okay? Now, what will happen to the fetal head?
Mom, fetal head will be in the opposite diameter. Yes. It will be in the right oblique diameter.
What is the engaging diameter here?
Occipitofrontal.
Suboccipitofrontal. Understood. So it is slightly more than a suboccipitopragmatic, which you get in cephalic presentation. A point below the occipital protuberance to the anterior end of the anterior frontal. Understood. So that will be about 10 centimeter. I said 10, 12, 10, right? So suboccipitofrontal is the engaging diameter. Head is slightly deflexed at that time, you know. And then there will be, what will happen?
Internal
rotation of the fetal head in the opposite direction now, okay? So here the breech had rotated this direction, shoulder also has rotated this direction, but fetal head will rotate in the opposite direction and it comes to the end anterior-posterior diameter of the outlet, understood? So now the flexion, there'll be complete flexion of the fetal head, internal rotation of the fetal head and
by flexion head is delivered.
Yeah. By flexion, first the chin, okay, the chin, the nose and the brow, everything is born first, okay, and the fetal head slips through. So this is how this is the mechanism of labor in case of a breech presentation. Understood? So head is born by flexion. Okay. Right. So now how do you conduct breech delivery? So patient is, you think that, okay, patient has come to you and you, decided that, okay, you will allow her for vaginal delivery and you are going to conduct the vaginal delivery. What are all the precautions that you take when you do, conduct vaginal delivery? It is always assisted vaginal breech delivery.
IV lines have to be sighted. Yes. Because yes. Risk of cesarean is at risk, ma'am.
Yeah.
If it doesn't go well, cesarean section has to be conducted.
Yes.
So she should be nil per oral and she should be on IV lines. Mm-hmm. And
whom all you'll inform?
Ma'am, obstetrician, neonatologist should be, sorry, pediatrician,
okay.
Anesthetist, sorry, ma'am. Anesthetist, yeah. And neonatologist.
Yes. Anesthetist and the neonatologist should be there. Yes. In by chance, like if there is any problem, you may have to do a cesarean. Okay. Now, unless you are an expert, you will not allow her for breech delivery, right? So you are the obstetrician. Oh, yeah. But you will need one more assistant. Okay.
Yeah.
Why you will need one more assistant?
Ma'am, in case of, in order to give suprapubic pressure to maintain flexion of the head.
That's the main reason.
And also, For forceps delivery of the head, we need assistant.
Yeah, after coming here, suppose you want to apply forceps, then you will need somebody to help you, isn't it? So one assistant always should be there. And you would have explained to the mother regarding all the this thing, counseling should be done and informed consent should be taken, that these are the things, you know, in spite of that, if she's insisting to have vaginal delivery, yes, she can have vaginal delivery. And do you want to give any anesthesia?
Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah. So you can give, say, epidural analgesia can be given. Yes.
Yeah, ma'am.
Because by chance, like, you know, to do any manipulations or suppose you want to do a cesarean also, it will be much easier, right? If facilities are there, yes, epidural analgesia can be given. Okay. It is not there. You think it is not there. Any anesthesia you would like to give?
Spinal, ma'am.
Spinal. No.
Epidural? No, ma'am. Sorry.
Have you heard of pudendal block?
Pudendal, no. Yeah, ma'am. Pudendal nerve block.
Yes. So pudendal block can be given because that will help you in doing some manipulations, even delivering after coming head and all that. Okay.
Yeah,
suppose you don't have facilities for epidural analgesia. Okay. When do you give episiotomy?
Ma'am, episiotomy in case of when the perineum is bulging and there is climbing of the perineum. So that time episiotomy can be given.
Yeah. So you should know, like, when the breech climbs over the perineum, what does it mean? Like, you know, when the anus is seen at the vulval outlet and that doesn't recede in between uterine contraction, that is a time for you to give episiotomy. Okay, fine. So you have to, it's better to give episiotomy because it will definitely help you in manipulations, isn't it?
Yes.
So some people say like you don't have to give, but we usually give even if she's a multiparous woman, no, we give episiotomy because it will even widen, not only widen the birth canal, it will shorten the birth canal. Understood? Okay. So you have given episiotomy, the breech is delivering. Okay, now think that it is not, see, if it is complete breech, then you won't have much headache with the this thing, but what buttocks, even the limbs are gone, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, you think that it is extended breech now. Anything you want to do?
Penance manoeuvre can be done, ma'am.
Yeah. Now, it's something like Pinard's maneuver. So, it is a decomposition of the breech. What is Pinard's maneuver?
Ma'am, in this, the fingers are carried up till popliteal fossa and popliteal fossa is pressed and abducted. So, this results in flexion of the legs and the ankle is grasped it's pulled out and breech extraction is done.
So actually you go along the popliteal fossa and just give an upward thrust. Okay. So the knee is flexed and you abduct the thigh. Then the whole leg is born. Okay. Same thing can be repeated on the opposite side also. Okay, fine. Now this is born and then anything else you want to do? The legs and the buttocks are born.
It has to be wrapped in the sterile cloth.
Okay, you will be, before that, anything else you would like to do?
Ma'am, at the umbilicus?
Yeah, see, umbilicus cord.
At the umbilicus is delivered, a cord should be drawn and it should be pushed to one side of the sacral vein in order to prevent cord compression.
Yes. So once it is delivered up to the, see, once the legs and the breech are delivered, it's almost up to the umbilicus, isn't it? So at that time, you can draw a pull loop of the cord and then you keep it aside so that it will prevent cord compression. And then you are wrapping the baby. Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
So when do you deliver the shoulders?
Ma'am, when inferior angle of the scapula is visible.
Yeah, so almost at the level, like you should be able to see the axilla, okay? So at that time, you can deliver the shoulders. So usually, like, you know, in the normal, and any other precaution you must take, one you said covering, one you said cord, third thing is, see, sometimes what happens is when there's restitution and this thing, external rotation, the baby may rotate backwards. You should prevent that from happening from that, you know. You have to always keep the back anterior. So you should prevent the baby from going backwards, okay? So keep the back anterior, dorso anterior it should be. And now you're seeing the inferior angle of the scapula, almost axilla is seen. Now, see, usually in the normal, this thing, it is normal thing I'm telling. You may just, what you have to do is just flex the elbow and it will just drop down. That's all, understood, for the shoulders, right? So, and next what you'll do?
Mom, and then we have to look for the parallelism between the vertebral column and vertebral border.
I'm not talking about difficult thing, okay? I'm not talking about all those maneuvers. In a normal case, see, it is delivery. You have done delivery of the buttocks and the legs, and then you have taken all the caution about the cord and the covering and dorso anterior, then delivery of the shoulders. So at the most, see, usually delivery can happen, but at the most, you may have to just flex the elbow and so that the arm will drop down, okay? Same thing you can repeat on the opposite side also, right? Okay, now this much is born. Now, how do you conduct the delivery of the after coming head?
By Bern Marshall technique, Bern Marshall manual. And
so most of the time, like, you just have to give a suprapubic pressure and until the occipital, like, you know, the nuchal line is seen, hairline is seen under the pubic symphysis, you don't do anything, no pulling, nothing.
Okay.
So in breech delivery, you should remember that all the maneuvers should be very gentle and they should be unhurried, okay? And you should never pull. You know, you like to pull somebody's leg. You know, you like it, isn't it? You enjoy pulling somebody else's leg. But here, no. Though it is breech presentation, do not pull the leg. Do not pull anything. It's always pushing from above. Understood? Yes. Yeah. So you ask your assistant to give suprapubic pressure. It is known as the Kristallars maneuver. You give suprapubic pressure so that there is flexion of the PT head. And most of the times, because of the gravitation, the baby's head will be delivered. Okay. Now we'll come to some difficult problems. Okay. So suppose there is difficulty in after coming shoulders, what you do? We talked about Pinard's maneuver for the this thing, legs. Okay. What about the shoulders?
Mom, for shoulders, this Lovsett's maneuver, Mom.
What is Lovsett's maneuver and what is the principle of Lovsett's maneuver?
Mom, the birth canal is curved. So if the anterior shoulder is present above the pubic symphysis, that means posterior shoulder will be present below the sacral promontory.
See, that's why I said, you know, posterior shoulder is born first. Understood? So the pelvis is tilted that way, right? So posterior shoulder will enter first and it is at a lower level than the anterior shoulder, right? So when you rotate the fetus through 180 degree, okay? So if the shoulder is this way, right? So you have to rotate through 180 degree. The shoulder which was posterior will deliver now. Understood? It will come out of the pubic symphysis. So that is the principle behind Lovsett's maneuver. So how do you hold a baby when you are doing Lovsett's maneuver? So it is femoral pelvic grip. So can you explain that?
Mom, the thumbs have to be placed over the sacrum.
Thumbs parallel to the spine. And the fingers should be over the iliac crest, okay, of the fetus. Okay, fine.
Okay.
So there should not be too much pressure over the abdomen to prevent visceral injuries. So even while doing Pinard's maneuver or say, suppose there is impacted breech and you're applying groin traction, the traction should be towards the legs and not towards the fetal abdomen. Understood? So you should not compress the fetal abdomen too much. There will be visceral injuries. You said no liver, kidney, adrenal, all those things. Right. Then, so that is Lausitz maneuver. Now, before that, you should identify whether the shoulders are extended or flexed. How to make out?
Mom, when there is parallelism between the vertebral column and vertebral border of the scapula, that means the arms are flexed. But if the parallelism is lost and there's winging of scapula, then that means it could be extended.
So if it is extended, sometimes no Lausitz maneuver may not be adequate enough. Understood? So that you may not be able to deliver the arms. In such cases, what do you do? Have you heard of classical method?
Yeah, mom, classical.
Yeah. So what you should do is you should lift the baby up like that, always in a posterior aspect along the curvature of the sacrum. Space is available, more space is available, isn't it? So you must take two fingers behind the humerus, okay? And then go along the this thing shoulder, and you can reach the elbow. You flex the elbow so that this arm is delivered in front of the fetal face. Just like that, it comes down, okay? Yeah. And again, you bring the baby back towards the mother's perineum, and same procedure for the anterior shoulder. Understood? So that is the classical method which you can do suppose there is difficulty in after coming shoulders. After coming head, how do you manage? They will always ask in the exam, you know, they will put the baby down through the pelvis and they will tell, okay, now the head, how do you deliver the fetal head? One, you said gravitation and suprapubic pressure, okay? If it is not delivered.
Mom, then Bern Marshall's maneuver or Ramala flexion shoulder traction can be done, or forceps delivery.
Yeah. Can you explain like Burns Marshall technique? How do you do that?
Mom, Burns Marshall technique, the baby is allowed to hang by its own weight, and then constant suprapubic pressure is given in downward and backward direction in order to maintain flexed attitude of the head. And once the nape of the neck is seen, then the ankles are grasped with fingers in between, and the trunk is swung in forward and upward direction towards the mother's abdomen.
Yes, in an arc over the mother's abdomen, it should be delivered, isn't it? So this is Burns Marshall technique, right? Okay. What is Mauricio Smelly Viet technique?
Mom, that is malaflexion and shoulder traction. On left supinated hand, the baby's trunk is placed, okay. And with the limbs hanging on either side, and the index finger and the middle finger are placed over the malar bone.
Okay.
And the pronated right hand is placed over the shoulder, the little finger and index finger over the right shoulder, and the index little and ring over the right shoulder, and index finger over the left, and the middle finger over the suboscipient foot.
And
ma'am, malar bone is flexed, and shoulder traction is given till the nape of the neck is visible.
Till the head is delivered, isn't it?
See, okay, nape
and is already seen. You have to flex it. You give malar flexion. So if you put the finger into the mouth, what can happen is there can be dislocation of the temporomandibular joint, one of the complications, okay? Now, sometimes there can be impaction of this breach. The breach may get impacted, especially the extended breach. So you may have to give groin traction. At that time, you may even dislocate the hip joints, understood? So in dislocation of the hip joints and fracture femur, we have seen some, even while doing cesarean section, people have fractured femur because same maneuver have to be used. Even the thing is, you are seeing and you are sure that, okay, you are going to deliver the baby in no time. But in a fight of your, can you hear me?
Yeah, ma'am, now you're audible. I don't know for some reason.
No, some internet you can hear, right? So what I was telling you. Use if it is a breach presentation.
Mom.
Got that point? Am I audible?
Yeah, ma'am, now you're audible. Earlier.
Hello?
Yeah, ma'am, now you're audible.
Okay. You got the point, no? What I told?
Ma'am, I couldn't hear. It was not audible, ma'am.
I said during cesarean delivery also, you may have to use the similar maneuvers as is of vaginal breech delivery if it is breech presentation. So we have seen people fracturing femur of the baby, okay, while delivering breech during cesarean delivery. Understood? So you should be very, very cautious and you should be very gentle while delivering the baby, okay? Now, what is the incidence of cord prolapse? It's 7:22 already.
Yeah,
what's the incidence of cord prolapse? Then we almost finished everything. We'll talk about external capillary question.
Mom, I think around 10 to 15%.
Yeah. It's actually footling presentation. It's about kneeling or footling presentation. It's about 15%, and if it is complete breech, it is 5%. Just easy to remember: 15%, 5%. And if it is frank breech or extended breech, it is same as in case of vertex presentation. It is about 0.5%. Okay. So that's the incidence of cord presentation. Now coming to external cephalic version. Okay. You said one of the options is external cephalic version. Now, one more thing I want just to finish off this breech extraction part. You said like all the maneuvers from starting from, from the delivery of the breech to shoulders to head, everything you are only doing. So that is called as breech extraction. And what are the indications for breech extraction?
Ma'am, breech extraction in case of frank breech. And delivery of the second twin.
Yeah, so it is mainly the delivery of the second of the
twin. Cord prolapse.
Breech extraction. Yeah, and full dilatation of cervix, cord prolapse, and there is a fetal distress, you need to deliver the baby immediately. In such a case, you may have to, do the breech extraction. Now, suppose you have not, you have not taken enough caution or whatever, and the baby's head comes through incompletely dilated cervix. What are the options that you have? You can accomplish delivery by some means. Now, head is trapped.
Ma'am, sorry, yes. Ma'am. Ma'am, could you repeat, ma'am? There was some kind of disturbance.
Okay, now the fetal head is trapped, okay, by incompletely dilated cervix. Can you hear me?
Yeah, ma'am. Yeah, ma'am.
The trunk has slipped through the, incompletely dilated cervix and head is entrapped. Cervix is not fully dilated. What do you do? Okay, baby is hanging out like that.
Mom, in this condition, malaflexion and shoulder traction can be done.
You cannot reach because the head is trapped.
Okay, cervix can be pulled up. It can be pulled up and baby can be delivered by malaflexion and shoulder traction, or else Dustin's incision can be given.
At 2 o'clock or 8 o'clock
position.
Yeah. So Dehresen's incision can be put and then you can deliver the after coming head. Understood. How do you apply forceps? Any special forceps can be used?
Ma'am, Piper's forceps.
Yeah, Piper's forceps. Of course, we don't have it in Vanivilla's hospital also. But I have seen it in some of the institute. They do use Piper's forceps. It's quite useful But remember that whichever forceps you are using, it should have a long shank, understood? So that you can apply.
Yes.
So here, of course, your assistant will help you. You have to wrap the baby's body and then slightly you have to lift, not too much because there may be extension of the fetal head, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
So apply the forceps and then it should hold the malar bonds like that, the biparietal diameter if possible. And then you have to deliver it. Understood?
Yes, ma'am.
Something. What do you mean by stargazing fetus?
That is the deflexed attitude of the fetus, ma'am.
It's not deflexed. It is extended, hyperextended, more than 90 degree between the neck and the
head. Yeah, ma'am. Extended. Yeah.
It is gazing at the stars.
Yeah.
Okay. So it is one of the contraindication for external cephalic version. You may have to do a cesarean operation. Okay. Right. Yeah. Now coming to external cephalic version, we talked so much about external cephalic. Can you tell me when to do external cephalic version? Can you do external cephalic version for all cases? Are there any contraindications?
External cephalic version generally at 37 weeks. If it is done before that, there are more chances of reversion. If it is done in later weeks, fetus is also big and there's no adequate amount of liquor. So 37 weeks is the best time to do external cephalic version. Contraindications like antepartal hemorrhage, placenta previa and abruptio placenta, then fetal complications like IUGR, then big baby in deflexed extended head, and then multiple pregnancy, abnormal cardiotocography, then when the fetal heart rate is not reassured, then maternal complications.
Now, I'll tell you something, okay. See, external cephalic version is done only when vaginal delivery is possible, okay?
Yeah, ma'am.
So if there is any contraindication to vaginal delivery, you are not going to do any external cephalic version. So the whole idea is with external, we know that perinatal mortality is more with breech presentation. You want to reduce that, incidence by converting it to a vertex presentation, isn't it? By external manipulation, that is external cephalic version, right? So there should not be any contraindication for vaginal delivery. If there is any fetal heart abnormality, are you going to do allow her for vaginal delivery? No, isn't it? So all those things are out. So there are typical contraindications, like you can write down this mnemonic, all of you. PPP. So whoever is free can write PPP. You keep writing one after the other letters. Tamasa, T-H-A-M-A-S-A. It is PPP Tamasa, okay? Somebody else can write. You can just listen maybe. Your friends can write and they can share it with you, okay? So the first P is pelvis, contracted pelvis. You are not going to do external cephalic version. Another P is pregnancy-induced hypertension or pregnancy-associated hypertension, whatever you call it now. Pre-eclampsia, eclampsia, you're not going to do because as such, there is increased risk of abruption with external cephalic version. So you're not going to do in pre-eclampsia, eclampsia, that is pregnancy-associated hypertension. Another P is precious baby. Suppose, say, she has conceived after, say, 10 years. Of course, every baby is precious. But more than that, the bad obstetric history, say after long year period of infertility, she has conceived or she has had recurrent abortion, miscarriages, and now it is term pregnancy with breech presentation, you are not going to take any risk, okay? Because there is a small risk of fetal loss here, okay? And Tamasa now, T-H-A-M-A-S-A, Tamasa. So T is for tumors, any tumors in the pelvis, say ovarian tumor or even fibroid. It may be difficult for you to do external cephalic version. H is for hydromnios. Hydromnios would be polyhydromnios as well as oligohydromnios. Both are not suitable for external cephalic version. There should be just enough liquor, understood? Then TH, A. One A is anomalies of the uterus. No, in those days, you know, earlier days, we were so enthusiastic to do external cephalic version. And in those days, ultrasonography was not so common and women used to come directly into labor. So we tried doing external cephalic version. No, we used to fail and then we used to wonder why. And while doing cesarean section, we have noticed that it was separate uterus. Okay. So anomalies of the uterus is a contraindication. You cannot do. Anomalies of the fetus, there is no point in doing. In fact, hydrocephalus means I'll be rather happy if it is breech presentation because I can do easily craniocentesis if it is a breech presentation. Understood? And that is one more A. PHA, one A is anomaly of the uterus. M is multiple pregnancy. One more A is anomaly of the fetus. S is previous scar. Any previous scar, you should be more cautious. It's rather relative contraindication. People who are daredevils, still they do external cephalic version. And A, another last A is for antepartum hemorrhage. Antepartum hemorrhage, like say abruption as well as placenta previa is a contraindication for external cephalic version. So this is how you can remember all the contraindications. Complications you have mentioned. She can go into preterm labor, premature rupture of membrane is possible, abruption can happen. And sometimes, like if you have used too much, of course, cord entanglement. Now, we had a case, you know, one multiparous woman. I did almost 3 times external cephalic version. All the time, it used to be very easy, but all the time, it used to go back to breech presentation. We were wondering like why it is like this. And finally, we thought, okay, anyway, she's a multiparous woman. She's willing for tubectomy. Let us do a cesarean. And while doing a cesarean, we found that there was a long cord and it had entangled all over the body, maybe because of our external cephalic question. Understood? So this is cord entanglement is one of the complications of external cephalic version, which you can detect. That's why you, like while doing ECV, should carefully monitor the fetal heart throughout the procedure and before and after you have to do one NST. Understood? And of course, a very rare complication would be rupture of uterus and sometimes amniotic fluid embolism. Also can happen. Yeah. So these are some of the complications. What anesthesia you give?
For Here, anesthesia is not required.
Vocal anesthesia. You have to talk to the woman, understood? So you should be vocally giving anesthesia to the woman. That means throughout the procedure, you should be talking to the woman, understood? So no anesthesia, but sometimes you can give tocolytics. Tocolytics will help in easy external cephalic version. You can give earlier they were giving terbutaline, now it is not given. You can give nifedipine tablet 10 to 20 milligram about 30 minutes prior to the procedure, and then you can do the procedure. Okay. So you do an preferably do an ultrasound examination, look at the position of the back, and then you do the external cephalic version. And how do you do it? Procedure?
Ma'am, first, using both the hands, breech should be moved to one of the iliac.
Can I show you the video if possible?
Ma'am?
Yeah. Shall I show you the video if possible? Is it possible? Share screen is there, na?
Ma'am, I'll make you the host, ma'am.
You should make me host.
Ma'am, you can share, I think.
I don't know. I'll see if possible. This will stop other screen sharing. Do you want to continue? Yes.
Ma'am, I'll stop sharing.
You stop sharing. Okay, fine. I have to open the presentation, is it?
Yes, ma'am.
In that case, can you see? No.
No, ma'am.
You cannot see, no?
No, ma'am.
One minute. This, yes, I have to go for the Zoom Share. I have to go for share, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Share. There is no option only. It's saying you are screen sharing. Okay. Your screen sharing, it is showing. I don't know.
Yeah, ma'am. I'm able to see the screen.
Okay. You can see it?
Yeah, ma'am. It's visible, ma'am.
Is it? It's visible?
Yeah, ma'am.
Now, this is a live video. Okay. I will mute it. Huh. This is a live video, actually. Can you hear me?
Yeah, ma'am, yeah.
Ha. So this is the head end of the patient, okay? I'm standing on this side. The whole video takes just 4 minutes. This is unedited. So I was, she's a multiparous woman, second gravida. First was normal delivery, and she had come at term. So this was done about 3 years back, I think so. Somewhere in 2018. So the breech is here and head is here and back is on the left side. Okay. So you have to, so there are two movements. One is roll forward or flip backward. Okay. So you have to ascertain the position of the back. Rolling forward would be a better option because the flexion attitude is maintained. But if that rotation is not possible, then you may have to do the flip backwards. So here I am doing the roll forwards because back is this side, head is here, and I'm trying to grasp the head and bringing it down. Okay, so my left hand will bring the head down, and with the right hand I'm pushing the breech up. Now, it's not that easy, like how, you know, you grasp the breech and you grasp the head and then you bring it down and you push it up. It is not so easy here, okay, in practice. So you should be very gentle, and throughout the procedure, I'm talking to the patient, I'm talking to the postgraduate students who are there, who are watching the procedure, okay. So slowly you have to bring the head. See, the whole procedure took about four and a half minutes, but for me to bring the head towards the to transverse position, it takes almost 3 minutes. The rest of the procedure will be much easier, okay? So from the head, from the fundus to come to towards the umbilicus, it takes longer time. So you keep doing it. With the one hand, you are pushing the head down, and you are pushing the breech up, okay? Right, now once it is transverse, I'm changing the hands now, okay? With my right hand, I'm pushing the head down, and with my left hand, I'm pulling the breech up, okay? So can you see the movements? It's different now, okay? So yeah, with the left hand, I'm pulling the breech up now. With the right hand, I'm pushing the head down. It's almost coming down. It's almost oblique, I should say. Now here, this is a beautiful case because the abdomen is very lax. In a primary gravida, abdomen will be very tight. Sometimes it may be difficult. Okay. See, now head has come almost up to the lower pole. So you should bring a little bit beyond the midline. The head should be brought beyond the midline so that you're sure that the head is at the lower pole now. See, now the palatable head has come to the lower pole, okay? Yes. So confirm that it is head. Now what will happen to the fetal heart? So the back was here on the left side, isn't it? So now the back will be on the right side. You just see now. So I am asking my postgraduate students also to ascertain that it is this thing. So she's checking the fetal heart on the opposite side now. Can you see that? And it is much below the umbilicus, right? So that means it is a cephalic presentation. Okay, so how do I stop sharing? Okay, fine, stop sharing. So was that clear?
Yeah.
So that was a live video, actually, without any, ideally speaking, we should do a CTG and NST should be done before and after. And you must check at the end of the procedure whether she has any rupture of membranes, any bleeding and things like that. The baby should be monitored. Actually, you just get one NST done. It will take 20 minutes. That means almost you are monitoring till then. Understood? So you have to monitor the patient and the baby, mother and the baby for at least 20 to 30 minutes. So that is an ideal situation, like where you can do external cephalic version. We have done external cephalic version for a primary gravida also. So once it so happened, like two patients were, both were gravida to para one. One was in early labor. And they had left the patient for cesarean. Our duty starts at 4 o'clock, if you all know about that, isn't it? So when I came at 4 o'clock for rounds, I saw two patients were left for cesarean. So what I did external cephalic version for both the patients. One was not in labor. One I put PG to gel and induced labor. And the other patient was already in early labor and she went into spontaneous labor and she delivered normally. The other one also, with this thing induction, she also delivered normally. And this primary, we had done the external cephalic version. We had sent her home because she was not in labor. She came back with labor pains and then she delivered later on normally. And once it so happened, we did external cephalic version for a lady when the cervix was almost 5 to 6 centimeters dilated. Can you believe that? That means even in active labor, if you are good enough and you're in between uterine contractions, you still can do external cephalic version. It will naturally, there'll be so many uncertainties when you do are conducting a breech delivery, because after coming shoulders may get stuck, after coming head may get stuck. So there are so many uncertainties, isn't it? So that's why you should be very, very cautious. And throughout this thing, you should remember that the bladder should be empty. Now we had an occasion, one patient was brought to the labor room with the body hanging out, already cord pulsation was absent. And it was very huge baby, very big baby. And she was having strong contraction. We were all worried where she rupture the uterus. Okay. So what we wanted to do was, I thought, okay, we will do craniotomy and reduce the fetal head size and then deliver the fetal head, because we used almost all methods, Mauritius Millie, everything was tried. We couldn't deliver. So just before that procedure, I just wanted to empty the bladder. You believe it or not, the moment I emptied the bladder, the one person was already giving suprapubic pressure to empty the bladder, the baby's head just dropped down. So remember, full bladder is a very bad during delivery. For anything, for an obstetrician, you should never have full bladder. The bladder should be empty. Understood? So all these small things you should remember. So I think you have really done well, Manasa. Studied quite a lot, and then hope you will answer in the exam also this way only. Wish you all the best. And I think, that will complete our discussion. Questions you have? Any questions? Thank you, madam. No questions. Higher transponder. Okay. Any questions are there?
No, ma'am, there's no questions.
There are no questions. Okay. There is only discussion. Okay. Yes, thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Yeah. Ma'am, any concluding remarks?
I said, Manasa has done very well. Okay. She has prepared, so I can only comment on her. So this breach, definitely it will be asked in the exam. They will ask you to show any, frank breach. You show frank breach. How is it like? And complete breach, they'll ask you to show. They may ask you to show left sacroanterior position, right sacroanterior position. They'll ask you to show delivery. How do you deliver after coming shoulders and after coming head is at the main, most of the time they'll ask. Pinards maneuver, usually UGs, they don't ask, but if you know, it's well and good, okay? Pinards maneuver, they may ask you. And of course, sectional cephalic question, they can ask you. In the exam, like you may get a short notes on external cephalic version or breach presentation, mechanism of labor in breach presentation, explain a long question, or they may give a case scenario, okay, primary this, and how do you manage? So remember that if she is more than 36 weeks, you can always write about external cephalic version, the contraindications, the complications, and the procedure itself. And then, give the options of assisted vaginal delivery or cesarean delivery, depending upon the Zadutny-Andros scoring system, breach scoring system, and things like that. How you arrive at, as to the mode of delivery. So the decision, how you take decision is mostly Zadutny-Andros scoring is a little bit practically, sometimes it may not be possible, but some of the factors we do take into consideration. Say multiparous woman with previous breech, and this time baby is average size 3 kg and the pelvis is good, and you have a frank breech or a complete breech, naturally you will allow for vaginal delivery. So some of the things, of course, you will take into consideration. So apart from that, I don't think I have anything to say. Wish you all good luck.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. It was indeed a comprehensive clinical class. The discussion was very useful for us. Thank you so much, Professor Malini ma'am, for teaching and guiding us. We are ever grateful to you. It was a great effort by presenter. We could learn a lot with her well-prepared presentation. We also thank all the participants who are enthusiastically answering and were actively involved. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you.
Thank you.